seems like you guys like have to.
All right, well, good morning, everyone. I'm Rob Atkinson, president of ITIF, and I want to welcome you to this event to look at and discuss ARPA-E, and in particular the relationship and the similarities and differences between ARPA-E as one model and DARPA as another model. So I think we've really got a great panel this morning. I'm going to introduce everybody, and then we'll have a presentation on kind of the overview of DARPA and then ARPA, and then we'll hear from our two colleagues at ARPA-E. And then, DARPA and ARPA-E is what I really meant to say. And then we'll have plenty of time for questions and discussion. So on my immediate left is Bill Von Villian. Bill is the director of the Washington, D.C. MIT office, has a long, long background in Washington on technology policy. For 17 years, he was the LD and chief counsel for Senator Joe Lieberman. And whenever you wanted to go up to the Senate and talk to the leading Senate person on tech policy, it was always Bill Von Villian.
That's why you're in so much trouble.
Maybe that's why we're in trouble now. Bill's also lectured and given speeches and taught at Georgetown, MIT, and George Washington. He's also on the Board of Science Education of the National Academy of Science. Dick Van Etta is an adjunct research staff member at the Strategy Forces and Research Division, Resources Division of the Institute for Defense Analysis, and also an adjunct at STEPI, the Science and Technology Policy Institute of the Institute for Defense Analysis. Dick's also had a long, long background in tech policy, particularly from the defense side. From 93 to 98, he was in DOD as a special assistant for dual-use technology policy and then assistant deputy undersecretary for dual-use and commercial programs. He's also an adjunct professor at Georgetown University's Security Studies Program and has a PhD from Indiana University. And Elon Agur is a senior advisor for commercialization at ARPA-E, the only real scientist on the panel, I think, accurate to say. The rest of us are faux scientists. He has focused on preparing breakthrough energy technologies and from the transition to lab, from lab to market. He has spent his career developing, commercializing clean energy technologies based on advances in material science. Prior to ARPA-E, Dr. Gurr served as co-founder and director of CO Inc., which is a venture-backed lithium battery company. He was also a PhD research fellow at UC Berkeley, where he developed a new class of low-cost photovoltaics based on printed semiconductors. And he was also a faculty member at UC Berkeley's Haas School of Business, and he holds a PhD in material science and engineering from UC Berkeley. And last on the far left is Peter Marburg, who is Assistant Director for External Communications at ARPA-E. Peter, prior to that position, served as senior policy fellow at the U.S. Nuclear Infrastructure Council, was also previously appropriations and ledge director for a senior member of the House of Representatives on Energy and Water Subcommittee. And he has his law degree from the University of Baltimore. So I also would be remiss if I didn't note when ARPA-E was created, the grandfather of ARPA-E is Congressman Bart Gordon, and Congressman Gordon is kind enough to join us today. So it was really his leadership that really helped drive and create the whole effort of ARPA-E and the successes it's shaped today. So appreciate you, your leadership there and joining us today. So we'll get started right away with Bill Von Villian.
So I'm going to say a few words of introduction and then hand off to Dick, who will go through some background on DARPA, and then I'll pick up with ARPA-E, and Dick will lead us in some conclusions. And we're engaged in a strict time limit. Matt here has got the clock that he'll flash at us. And Rob is, wait a minute, I'm not going to count these 3 seconds. Wait a minute, it's not. Rob will pull us off the stage literally if we exceed our 20-minute time frame. So, but there will be, by rushing us through this stuff, and both Dick and I love to talk too much, You'll actually get a chance to do a lot of energetic Q&A, which we're counting on you on. We might see a lot of familiar faces in the audience and hope for some really interesting discussion. Just by way of quick background, DARPA, as the folks in this room know well, was formed from the Sputnik Challenge in 58. It was formed with an idea of avoiding technology surprise, a Sputnik-like technology surprise, but that evolved to the concept of creating technology surprise. It was recognized for spurring fundamental breakthroughs in both military and commercial technologies. ARPA-E was a conscious attempt to apply the DARPA model to energy technology development. It was originally discussed in the National Academy's famous Gathering Storm report, 2006. Congressman Bart Gordon was definitely the leader and founder and creator through the America Competes Act of the ARPA-E model, which he got authorized in an almost superhuman effort, 2007. It got initial appropriations from the stimulus legislation in FY 2009, which gave it a substantial start. Again, Congressman Gordon played a critical role in that funding. It got a very interesting, went through a very interesting appropriations battle that we can get Petter to tell us about, but actually won a floor fight in the House this past year, so it's now sitting on a $275 million FY12 appropriations. I wouldn't say it's sitting pretty, but it's in a lot sounder shape than it was before that funding came through. So this is going to be an enduring entity. It's going to be around. The topics we're going to cover are first, as I mentioned, DARPA, and Dick's going to take us through some of the traditional DARPA rule set elements. Many of you are familiar with these. And then through some less well-known DARPA elements, less understood, but nonetheless very important. And then I'll come back to the stage and talk about ARPA-E, what rules got adopted from DARPA, and what, interestingly, what are the new rules? What are the new directions that ARPA-E is taking us, largely in response to the energy challenge? And then what are some of the lessons that DARPA has continued to evolve that could play back as ARPA-E itself matures? And then Dick will close with the challenge to both DARPA and ARPA-E in a time of difficult technology implementation. So with that, let me do a handoff.
Also, there are a bunch of seats up front.
Yeah, a lot of seats up front, so please come on in.
Sorry about that.
Good morning. Glad to see everybody eager to have a vibrant discussion on these issues. Point I want to make about DARPA, as Bill pointed out, it was created because of an emergency, but it was also created because of a massive gap, a major gap in the DoD R&D technology development arena. And that gap was that you had traditional service R&D structures that were very well capable of developing traditional systems and capabilities. For the Army, it was ground forces and things from the ground, and the Air Force, obviously, things in the sky, and the Navy was ships, right? And so, obviously, when DARPA was created, one of the first things that had to deal with was the fact that there was an issue to go into space because of the Sputnik challenge. In fact, one of DARPA's first spinoffs was NASA. And so about half of the original DARPA staff left, and about half of the IDA staff that helped set up DARPA went with it. And, of course, each of the system people had the opportunity to then offer up why they weren't going into space, and they said, well, we should be able to do this. Army, obviously, this is artillery, so it's just projection of that, and for the Air Force, it was in the sky, only above the sky in terms of non-atmospherics, and the Navy had the best one of all, which is, of course, it's ships, spaceships, right? So the problem was that nobody knew how to take on the new turf versus the fact they had these vested interests in what they were already doing. So, in fact, DARPA was itself a disruptive invention, disruptive innovation in how to do innovative R&D and technology development. Its purpose was to do things differently. It was, in fact, not to do the stuff that the incumbent R&D system was good at, but to find things that weren't being done and find ways of doing those. It was to take risks that the others wouldn't take, and others, organizations wouldn't take, and part of the way of getting rid of that risk was not to be, to take that kind of risk was not to be trammeled by the large, massive R&D structures of the laboratories and all of that that the services had. To do that, they had to do things differently, and this shows you here the kinds of things that they did in terms of organization that were different. First of all, they had program managers, they had office directors, and the director, and that was it. And those program managers had the empowerment to run their own programs based upon their own concepts of what needed to be done that were designed around challenges, not around pushing specific technologies, but in fact to reach goals and objectives that were defined in terms of needs and but not requirements. So they're beyond the service requirements. To do that, you need to bring in talented individuals who are willing to take risk, who are only going to be there for 3 to 5 years and therefore had no vested interest in just sustaining something and keeping it going. The research was formed externally. There were no R&D laboratories. DARPA, in fact, explicitly eschewed the notion of having its own laboratories because then you're stuck with the legacies and trying to care and feeding of those organizations. If you're looking for new ideas, you can't look to an existing structure that is bedded in the old ideas. Therefore, you're focusing on this high-risk, high-payoff notion, taking those risks and challenges. One way to get those ideas going is you put a little bit of money out for the seeding, see which of those work, see which ones have promise according to the famous now Heilmeier catechisms, and then move those forward in terms of the potential implementation based upon a very serious internal vetting by the program manager himself, the office director, and then the director in terms of which of these gets kicked up to a higher level of funding. And if things aren't working, they're terminated. And I have some examples of that, but I don't have time to go into that right now, but we can talk about that later. Next slide, please. Oh, I got to do the next slide. I get to do the next slide. So, what is not well known about what is not as well known about DARPA is that, in fact, while it had this quick payoff, quick turnaround, high-risk-oriented notion, over time with these challenges it developed what I called multi-generational technology thrusts that it's known for. For example, standoff precision strike. DARPA, in essence, invented with its colleagues in the OSD, et cetera, the notion of standoff precision strike and iteratively developed technological capabilities that improved our capabilities to get there, but didn't just say, here's one thing and then stop, but said, what's the next thing to do? Where else can we go? But it did this not in terms of, well, we just have to keep doing this, but it's based upon what more needs to be done relative to the challenge that's out there. Some people say, well, you know, DARPA just does projects. Well, DARPA is a projects agency, but it does this with an overarching need of challenges that are well articulated sometimes, often by the Office of Secretary of Defense, sometimes by the Secretary of Defense, sometimes by the President. And those challenges then become the driver for what needs to be done. And when ARPA-E was set up, one of the things I wished that had happened was that there were 3 presidential challenges that came down that said this is what ARPA-E should do, because that's how DARPA got started with 3 presidential challenges: space, missile defense, and detecting Soviet nuclear tests was a crucial issue. In fact, when DARPA took that on, it essentially invented seismic sensing that is now used in the oil industry and all around the world. Complementary strategic technologies. When you're meeting challenges, you don't chase one single technology. You seek sets of technologies that can solve problems. And the integration of those, interrelation of those, was something that DARPA became quite skilled at, particularly in the information technology area. And another thing that DARPA did is it created what I called the change state advocates, a community of change state advocates, by bringing together a community that didn't exist at the beginning. There was no computer science programs, no computer science discipline before DARPA created information technology under the leadership of Licklider. And with the development of the concepts that were pursued at MIT, Caltech, UC Berkeley, et cetera, over time, that community of change state advocates that was drawn from those programs, funded by the programs, program managers themselves, but also the people they funded, grew into a burgeoning new community that became, in fact, the IT community that we now today know today. And so we can give DARPA credit for creating, in fact, change state advocate communities, including Precision Strike, the community. The corporation called Northrop Grumman succeeded because it bought into the concepts that are developed by DARPA in unmanned systems, standoff precision strike, etc. The director of the programs there went to this funny little company called Northrop at the time, which is a boutique aircraft design company, took that notion, built it forward, and it became the basis for why Northrop Grumman grew so successfully, because it looked to the future with these new ideas, bringing that community into the industrial practice. A couple other key points. DARPA doesn't do anything by itself. DARPA is an instigator. It funds things to others through vision and direction of others. It formulates those ideas and then connects and interrelates those together through the community. It finds people hiding in the bowels of the services that are frustrated about something like an invisible airplane. And Ken Perko was in the basement of the Air Force Research Laboratories getting no support. DARPA found him, brought him forward, and he became the program director for stealth. He would have never succeeded in that in the Air Force. It takes on incumbents. I just mentioned stealth. They took on the Air Force, basically, in terms of an invisible airplane that couldn't defend itself, could only fly at night. The Air Force wasn't particularly enthused about that. It had lots of other ideas of what it wanted. DARPA created the alternative aircraft to meet a very specific mission that the Air Force was not particularly interested in doing. The IT world was dominated before DARPA by a funny company, a great company, called IBM. But there were relatively few alternatives to IBM. And in fact, in terms of getting R&D and technology development out for new kinds of concepts of computers, while IBM had them, they were going to implement them on their own time, in their own way, for their own business interests. IBM basically owned the R&D and technology development of computer science. DARPA created the alternative that created a whole new competitive dynamic that actually stimulated the competitiveness of IBM as well as the rest of the industry. Okay. And so the other thing they also did was became the first adopter of key technologies and key developments as well. So with that, let's go to the next slide here and say that the other thing is most of DARPA's implementation in the military DARPA doesn't implement anything. Most implementations of DARPA were based upon its linkages in defense to the Office of Secretary of Defense. And we'll come back and talk about that when we talk about some of the issues that we're facing today. And DARPA did not just create technologies in the commercial world and say, forget about it. They said, we want these implemented. We will help you implement them. And we'll talk a bit about that when we get into implementation. But it's very important to realize that most of the implementations that DARPA took on, it actually helped foster through looking at relationships with others and how those can move forward, including the venture capital community. And so, Bill?
I need a script.
So let me just, ARPA-E is incorporated. We're shifting now to the ARPA-E story. ARPA-E has incorporated many elements of the DARPA model, I think, quite successfully. Flat organization, non-hierarchical, empowered program managers, a very streamlined project approval process that can move very fast, the right-left research model, deciding what you want to get out of the end of the innovation pipeline and then going back to the left side of the pipeline to figure out the breakthroughs that will lead you there. It's very challenge-based, like DARPA, focused on truly revolutionary breakthroughs for most of its portfolio. World-class talent. I mean, an amazing assemblage of talent with experience on both the academic and industry side. They have a waiver of civil service hiring authority that Congressman Gordon was able to get them. It's virtually unprecedented. It means they can move very fast in hiring. The project yardstick is the lifetime of their project managers, their program directors, as they're called, ARPA-E. The 3 to 5 year period that they will stay. The statutory limit is 3, but it can be extended. They have other transactions authority, a very flexible authority to be able to contract fast if they need to use it. They use a hybrid model. They combine academic researchers of great quality with particularly small startup companies, but sometimes large companies. So there's a connection between the commercial side and the more basic research side. And they use an island bridge model. They're on an island over next to the Forrestal building, somewhat protected, but they've got very strong bridges back to the leadership of the Department of Energy. But what are the new elements? What's different about ARPA-E? The forcing mechanism here is that the energy challenge is very different than the defense challenge. ARPA-E has got to land its technologies into what we could call a complex established legacy sector, energy, right? And that's a very difficult landing process. You literally have to parachute technologies in and think of of the Normandy parachute landings, right? That's the atmosphere in which they're going to land. It's not a necessarily receptive environment. It's a very difficult stand-up process. So that guides a large part of the different kinds of rules that ARPA-E has developed. So one area that they've worked hard on and developed some new ideas has been in the in an effort to sort of sharpen the research vision, the selection and support of their research. They're vision-based, right? They're attempting to achieve a technology vision. This is not incremental advance. They start with a big picture idea of where they want to get to and then work back from that. That's a very different way than most R&D agencies work. Obviously, it's similar to DARPA. They work on the white space of technology opportunity. Think of the whiteboard. They want to occupy parts of the whiteboard where nobody else is working, where new breakthroughs are possible. They use a very interesting two-stage selection process that's unique. And it comes out of the experience of their leadership, who often got frustrated by the review process for grant applications, that the reviewers didn't really understand what they were getting at. So they give the applicants a shot at the reviewers. There's a comeback. And it's interesting how that's sharpened the evaluation process. It puts the reviewers on their toes, but it puts the applicants on their toes, too, because they know they'll have to really effectively make their case. An empowered program manager culture. They want program managers who are not just great at science and technology, but have religion. You know, this is an evangelical group. They are out to make the case for the vision directions they want to move in. They have a very interesting fellows program. You know, a successful agency is a continuous learning environment, and bringing in recent, really talented PhDs creates this whole mentoring commentary process in the project selection area and in these technology areas that's very intriguing and different. They use a portfolio approach looking and developing a range of risks in the technology vision areas that they're pursuing. So some will be extremely high risk, the rest will be high risk, and maybe there's some shorter term stuff that nobody's working on but potentially could be realized fairly soon. So they have a range of technology elements in their tech thrusts. They have hands-on relationships with their awardees, right? They want to really connect. Most agencies, you get a grant award so long to your selectors, right? Spend your money, do your project, hand in a report. ARPA-E is very different. This is a very engaged process. Their program directors are out there holding hands with their research teams, both in industry and in the academic sector. So they become allies and assistants and aides and supporters and advocates as these projects move along. The second area is in building a support community. You know, in this city, you not only have to get the substantive model right, you've got to get the political model right. Otherwise, the substantive model disappears, right? And you've got to get a political model that supports the quality of the substantive model. So DARPA has been able to do that. Dick talked about building the support community there. ARPA-E has been engaged in a comparable exercise of getting that political support effort to work. So it's not only external. They've got very complicated relationships with very powerful existing agencies in DOE that they've got to figure out how to get along with, right? So they've been, I believe, particularly successful in the white agencies. They're working hard with the labs and the Office of Science as well. How do you become, in effect, an entity that serves the needs and supports the mission of the other components within the department so that they become allies, not competitors for funding and your enemies on the Hill? They do a fascinating summit. They've done two so far, the third's coming up. They pull in an incredible community of talent from industry and from the foreign leadership world in energy. It's an amazing event. It's one of the top energy events of the year now. Interestingly, they designed it so that they could build alliances with their losers. Their initial award process, they had so many more applicants than they were able to give out awards, but they had to turn down a lot of great stuff. So they said, look, let's invite them into the tent and build an event where they can connect up with the venture community, with industry. Let's build a larger community, not just a lot of frustrated people that didn't get grant awards. Interesting model to build that community. And so that has come a long way, that support advocacy community. A third area is on technology implementation. ARPA-E thinks about the implementation process during the award and research project process. So it's contemplating not just what a great technology would be, but how would it actually land? How could you get to a level of pricing, for example? Could this technology get to a level of pricing, or would it actually be able to compete on its own in the energy sector? So it's thinking about the implementation process during research. Again, most federal agencies don't do this. It works on in-reach within DOE as part of its implementation approach. How can it build alliances within DOE to help it move its technologies along, particularly with the applied agencies? It's working on ties to the Defense Department, which plays a potentially very interesting role in test beds and initial market creation on the energy side. And it uses the halo effect. When you get an ARPA-E award, you realize you're something, right? And so does everybody else. And that alone helps move and speed its technologies towards further advance. And just to move to wrapping up here, ARPA-E understands that the venture capital world, the entrepreneurship world, by which we typically stood up technology advances in the last 25 years, and that's a community that in some ways was co-created with DARPA. The yardstick is not the 5 to 7 years that the venture community uses, right, in energy. The energy yardstick is at least 10 years before we can get a serious commercialization tech stand-up process. So the support model that we develop for innovation, look, it's not fitting, right? So ARPA-E is thinking about how do you build a different kind of longer yardstick that's going to work in implementation? How do you connect with the industry stage gate process? A very different process than the visioning approach that ARPA-E uses. But if it's going to connect up with industry for its technologies, they've got to understand the stage gate selection process. How do you encourage consortia within sectors? You know, build communities around technology advances. So those are some of the approaches that ARPA-E is attempting to use as it matures. And then it's going to need to think about some of the lessons Dick was talking about, multi-generational technology thrust, strategic relations between technologies, the confluence with the real advocacy community, connection to larger innovation elements, taking on incumbents, the first adopter initial market role. All these issues that DARPA has kind of been through in one way or another have lessons for ARPA-E that could potentially apply here. And just to start to close this out, and then I'll turn it over to Dick in a second. What are the issues that face DARPA and ARPA-E ahead? What are the next round of challenges? Both have a really serious problem on what happens to their technologies. These are not technology implementers, but they need to think about how that will evolve. ARPA-E has been working very hard on this model. The defense procurement decline is going to affect DARPA's ability to make its implementation model work in the kind of ways that it did in the past. And, you know, the venture model doesn't work for a lot of technology fields, certainly including energy. So it's already hard for ARPA-E. They're already diving into this. Both agencies are going to have to focus more on that kind of back end of the innovation system and how they connect up to it. They won't take on this role. That's not their job. But how do they connect better to it? We think that's the kind of big challenge ahead. Dick? Dick will give us the wrap-up.
We said we're kind of going ahead. I'll see how much trouble I get myself into here. Nobody is perfect, and these organizations have been through lots of ups and downs. DARPA is 50 years old, so there's a tendency to become somewhat jaded or kind of stuck in your ways, but it's still very vibrant, and I think the new organization is trying to regenerate that. One point I want to make is that the role of the office director at DARPA has had huge impacts in terms of providing the kind of vision that Bill talked about. One of the concerns over the last several years, essentially in my view, was the let's say evisceration of the role of the office director as the visionary who would keep that focus going forward and having that kind of impact. Too much focus on individual projects, losing the broader perspective and losing the broader challenge focus. I think that's being reinstilled. I think it needs to be, and so you can have the Kent Cresses and the Licklighters and the kind of impact they had on creating that perspective that the individual office program managers who are in and out don't have. I raised this point in terms of is DARPA developing a BAA-itis. When the DARPA was first created, there was no BAAs. Guys came in with that's a broad area announcement where you put out something, we're trying to do something, and you say it's we're trying to achieve this, send in your proposals, send in your concepts proposals. Well, if you just rely on the BAAs, what you get is thousands of things in, and the question of, well, how do you assess, evaluate, and vet those if you don't already have some good concept of the challenge and the output and the things you're trying to do. But if you send your BAA out, how do you send it out in a way that doesn't say, guess what we're trying to get from this and how we're trying to do it, and then evaluate the guys not in terms of their ideas, but whether or not they're getting to the solution you have in mind. And the concern I have, and I've gotten this from industry, so if the guys from DARPA are here saying, well, you know, well, what are you talking about here? Companies, people out there, innovators said, I don't know how to get in. I try to write a response to a BAA, but they are already telling me what the solution should be as opposed to what the problem is they want to have solved. Now, that's just a warning to DARPA that you have to be careful how you present your notions in terms of being open to new approaches and new ideas as opposed to saying, solve the problem towards this way. So that's just a caution I'm putting out there. The biggest problem both organizations face is, what have you done for us lately? How are you going to get something done? DARPA in particular, okay, 50 years, you know, Vanana's written up these assessments in the past that said you've done wonderful things. Show me what you've done now. And one of the problems with DARPA is that it faces implementations into the military services that I say is basically failing today. And I'll just say two things. Future Combat System and Global Hawk.
No, I mean, say one thing. Got to wrap up.
Okay. So with that, I want to say that both these organizations face fundamental issues of implementation, and how to get to those implementations is a crucial issue that we have to face today.
Great. Good, thank you. All right. Elon?
So thanks to Rob for having us here, and I want to also thank Bill and Dick, because every time I hear these guys speak, I jot down notes furiously because we're learning, you know, on every word. So my name is Elon Gore. I'm with ARPA-E, and I just wanted to we wanted to now give some perspective. I think from the introduction, you know actually a lot about ARPA-E, but somewhat in abstraction. And so wanted to introduce the agency and give a little more flavor and color to what we're doing, and hopefully you'll see the connections to some of the elements that Dick and Bill spoke to this morning. And afterwards, we'll have some time for discussion about it. So one of the important things to note about ARPA-E is, yes, we're an aggressive agency, we're high risk, high reward in terms of our focus, but as Bill mentioned, we're very much mission driven. And the way we think about our mission in a very broad sense, there's this picture on the right, which you might be able to see, sort of a map of the United States, and really three legs to a stool, with the innovations and energy technologies at the bottom. And the three legs are our national security, our economic security, and our environmental security in the United States. And really, that's the guiding principle, is that if we're able to take a lead in energy innovation, we can speak to and solve all of those problems in some way. The mission of ARPA-E is really important, and we're very much a mission-driven agency, and the mission from Congress in our statute is very clear. Okay, so one is to enhance the economic and energy security of the United States, and it's very clear what specifically we're talking about here. ARPA-E's job is to support and develop new advanced technologies, which, if successful, will lead to a significant impact in one of these areas, period. Right? Reduce energy imports in the United States, improve energy efficiency in the United States, and reduce emissions related to energy use in the United States. Okay? So one thing that's very important is that everything we do in the agency, this is the hard filter that we put on it to say, is this something we should be doing or not? If we think we can make not an incremental but a very substantial impact in one of these areas, that's something that's for us to be thinking about, if the solution is a technology solution. And so on the right, and this language all comes straight from our statute, it talks about how we're supposed to find solutions, right? Translating scientific discoveries into technological innovations. And I think it's important to note that within the Department of Energy, if you looked at the existing structure, we had the Office of Basic Science, which essentially developed science with no consideration for a use, right, or for an application. Creative science, extremely important. That's most of our amazing discoveries come from creative science, right? So that's one part of the Department of Energy, historically. The other part is the applied research programs, which look at what the industry is doing today in a technological area and say, how can we drive innovation so that these roadmaps that the industries have can move faster? We can accelerate these roadmaps. Now, ARPA-E sits very squarely in between those, in the sense that the existing model would have been a scientist is funded by the basic science Department of Energy Basic Sciences, comes up with an idea. The folks who are working on the industry on the applied side say, oh, well, to make a slightly better engine, this innovation might be useful. So I'll take that scientific idea and I'll try to apply it to move the industry a little bit farther, right? But what we're able to do is take scientific inventions that come up and actually try and think of ones where if everyone thinks that's a crazy idea, but if we were able to support it and if it were successful, it wouldn't incrementally improve the existing industry's roadmap. It would completely blow it out of the water, right? The applied research programs of DOE would have to think of an entirely new way of doing things, which would be much, much better than today's. Okay, so that's kind of the role. It's a matter of taking science and translating it into a whole new way of doing things on the applied side. What makes ARPA-E unique from other programs? I think a lot of this was spoken to already. The goal is unique, right? We're looking at non-incremental innovations, things that will be transformational versus what the industry would do anyway. The structure, and I think it's important to note, some of the things that make ARPA-E unique were sort of bestowed upon us through the wisdom of Congress that in our statute said, this should be your goal, right? And here are some ways how you can have a structure. Right, in the sense of we're a nimble, flexible organization. Well, we're able to be that partially because of the way we can, plan and budget our activities. Partially because we have some special hiring authorities that let us bring people in and out. We have term limits on our employees, which again keeps us refreshing the organization. That comes from Congress, and then the organization initially was able to really build a culture, which hand in hand with the model. Really drove to a successful outcome. And so some of that is in the DNA, right? Excellence. Well, we're all trying to build organizations with great excellence. So that may not be unique, right? But we do have a pretty unique culture. And one of the important ones that I'll mention here is constructive confrontation. We have a culture at ARPA-E where we're trying to get the best minds from across the country to come in and create the visions for the programs that we fund. But there's sort of a policy of, if you're someone whose ego gets bruised easily, you may want to leave it at home, right? Because when we're thinking about a new activity and we're thinking, well, does this match our mission? Is this really worth doing? We're really confronting each other and challenging each other constantly. And I think it's a very important part of the agency. Of course, the focus is pretty unique. As I mentioned, not incremental advances in the traditional roadmaps and learning curves, but innovations which would create entirely new ways of doing things. And then the approach, and I think Dick spoke to this a little bit, but right, we're trying to promote breakthrough technologies in science, but we want to do it with a consideration of, if this succeeds, will it actually make an impact? Will it actually be adopted by the industry and end up in the world making the impact that we're trying to make? So I want to just give an example to, again, bring out some flavor of a few of the programs that we've been able to run so far. And I think this will help bring some color to some of the aspects of the organization. And I'll start with biofuels. So if we look at biofuels and we look at photosynthesis, I mean, the sun is an incredible resource that we have. Okay, right? There's this, when I worked on solar, we used to say there's enough energy hits the earth from the sun in an hour to power the planet for a year, right? It's pretty remarkable. Now it turns out it's not quite true, right? The world's using a lot more energy every day, and so a lot more power every day. And so we actually can't quite make it a year, but it's pretty close, right? It's an incredible resource. If you look at photosynthesis, the issue you have is you're generally taking sunlight, you're using an existing base of plants that we find in the world, corn, sugar cane, etc., to absorb the sunlight, create sugars, and then we try and convert that into a fuel that we can use to drive our cars, okay? And that takes sunlight. It also pulls in CO2, which is great. And it takes water to grow the plants, obviously fertilizer, etc. The issue we have is that traditional plants that we know of, this whole process from, you know, energy, the power we get from the sun to the energy in the fuel is less than 1% efficient, okay? Which means you need a lot of land, you need a lot of resources to support the growth, etc. So a lot of people have thought of better ways to do biofuels. You know, can we use cellulose? Can we use other parts of the plants, etc.? We had a program director, one of the first program directors in the agency who came in, Eric Toon, who was a professor at Duke University, studied biology, was not in the energy space, okay? And this is something that we found is very valuable for us. Getting perspectives of experts, scientific, technical experts, who don't necessarily understand the space, but who can quickly learn and adapt thinking from their background to this new space spurs innovation, okay? So Eric looked at this problem and he said, great, photosynthesis, but it's so inefficient, right? He had some experience working with some biology, some types of microorganisms which actually don't use photosynthesis. So if you think, if anyone's been scuba diving, right, or you watch the Discovery Channel, right, you hear about these organisms that sit at the bottom of the ocean, right, where there's no light, and whether it's sulfur coming up, etc., they can basically grow and thrive off of without light. Okay? And he knew about this, and he said, well, some of those metabolic pathways of converting those things into energy to fuel those organisms can actually be more efficient than this 1% for photosynthesis. So he said, has anyone ever looked at trying to use that to make fuel? Okay. Turns out, not many people had. And so he came up with this vision that we now in the agency, talking about sort of a whole new technology thrust, we call electrofuels. And he said, well, if you take these bugs, you can actually use them to have electricity, right? Have them take electricity as an input and produce fuel, okay? And so you can now imagine having electricity come in, still pulling CO2 out of the atmosphere with a non-photosynthetic microbe to produce a fuel. And it turns out that theoretically, this could be more than 10 times as efficient as a photosynthetic process, okay? So this is something that only could have, you know, he only came to this because he thought, well, you know, this is something I've seen before in my work. Hadn't really thought about this problem, but hey, this is pretty interesting. And so now let me just step back and give you a sense of the process, okay? So Eric has this just tidbit of an idea, right, this itch when he comes into the agency. And first he sort of, you know, chats in the hallway and says, well, what do you think about this? You know, is this crazy? Is this insane? And people say, oh, this sounds kind of interesting, okay? So then the process starts. And he says, all right, I want to dig into this. Okay. Step one is go find as many smart people as you can in the energy field, outside of the energy field, who would have any thoughts on this, and try and get some input, right? And we don't know anything, but try and get some input. Buy the books to do the research to see whether this makes any sense. Do the calculations. Have some internal discussions. Then once we think, yeah, maybe there is something here, we try and hold a workshop where we engage the outside community, right? From academia, from industry, get as much feedback to say, does this make sense? Are there enough good ideas out there, right? If we try to do this as a set of opportunities we'd like to fund, are there going to be enough interesting different ideas out there to make for a really strong and rich portfolio of projects that might work on something like this? What should the targets be, right? No one's ever thought about this before. So should we immediately tell people we want them to come up with something 10 times more efficient than photosynthesis? Maybe that's too big of a step right out of the gate, right? Maybe it should be 5%, right? So we have that community, we have that engagement with the community. Then we come back, Eric will come back into the agency. Then he's got to put a thesis together around what this should look like and pitch it, and everyone at the agency has to say, yeah, this, you hit it, right? You nailed it, okay? And if not, it's go back to the drawing board, right? Try it again. Come back in 3 weeks and, you know, we'll have another conversation. We'll all throw daggers at you and see if you survive. And if it survives, then we actually will put out a solicitation and say, okay, to everyone in the U.S., we don't care where you are, who you are, if you have a great idea in this area, right, we want to support it. And we end up choosing in an area like this, so in this case, you know, we end up choosing somewhere between 10 and 15 projects that will fund for the course of 2 or 3 years to go from what at first seems like a crazy idea to ideally lower the risk enough through the technology development so that at the back end, you look at this and you say, well, hey, maybe this actually would work, right? And so then the academic community says, oh, wow, this is something we should really work at, if it works, right? The private sector will say, oh, this is pretty interesting. We should maybe be investing in this versus another thing. And that's how the process works. So I wanted to just give the flavor of that. And this is one example. So another example in biofuels, and this will give the flip side of the coin, right? Same problem of photosynthesis, right? We have another program director, Jonathan Burbaum, who came in. His background wasn't in academia. He actually knew a little bit about energy. He came from biotech, from industry. And he came in and he said, you know, it's not a matter that we need a completely different approach where we go from electricity. The issue I see in his mind was that, you know, we know there are plants out there, right, like sugarcane in Brazil, which can convert sunlight to electricity in an economically viable way and with pretty good yields, et cetera. We can't make those in the U.S., right? Sugarcane doesn't grow in the U.S., right? What if we were able to design a plant which actually could be more productive than sugarcane, right? Even more efficient, more yield, but that could grow and thrive in the United States, right? One of the issues you see in his mind, one of the issues you see is that we're trying to use these plants, right? Plants did not evolve to make fuel, right? Plants evolved to, you know, reproduce, they evolved to grow in the backyard, right? Whatever it was, we were able to actually create plants that enormously increased productivity for food, right? Can we think about the same type of principles for fuel? And so his view was, okay, he set a target after going through the same process, which just said, can you come up with another approach to create a plant that would grow in the United States and give you biofuels at twice the productivity of what corn does, right? So beat sugarcane in Brazil, do it here in the US. And it was a wide open, give us your best ideas. And so now you get a sense of the different flavor of ideas that comes out. I'll give you a sense of two of them, right? One is we know that there are algae, forms of algae that when stressed environmentally create fuel, right? They create oils. And that oils can be easily converted to fuel. So one proposal that came in, which we've actually selected for funding, said, can we take the same metabolic pathways that algae uses and embed them in tobacco, right? Tobacco, we know, grows like wildfire, right? We can grow tobacco in the U.S. That's something we know. Can we have a tobacco plant which creates oils like an algae would, right? Because it's very hard to get the oil out of algae. Be very easy to do so for tobacco and get the best of both worlds. So our director likes to joke that this would combine, you know, big oil and big tobacco, right, for the benefit of the United States. And it, you know, it's just mind-boggling, right? Another one, and sometimes, you know, we get these ideas in, and sometimes, you know, something comes out completely of left field that you never would have guessed. So there had been some work going on in this. You know, Jonathan had seen a lot of folks from the community said this is an interesting direction to go. And one that completely out of left field, and we've got a project now, basically said, well, we know that pine trees, right? Pine trees can produce things that are pretty close to oils, terpenes, right? And similar, think in your head of maple syrup, right? You can get a pine tree that's actually producing some fluid inside. Could you create a pine tree which would very efficiently produce terpene that you could tap and easily convert to oil? Okay. Now think about it, it's a biofuel, it's just a tree that you tap for oil. Unbelievable sort of new innovation. Will it work? We have no idea, right? We have no idea, but hopefully in 2 or 3 years we will have an idea of whether it will work. So that's something that we're pretty excited about. I don't have a lot of time, so I'm going to move on. One last example, and this is a different type of approach as well. So this is a beast, batteries for transportation, okay? Everyone knows that electric vehicles are kind of right on the verge, right, of really becoming widespread. What's the big issue? Well, the battery has a limited range, and it's too expensive. You know, I'd love to buy an electric vehicle. You know, hopefully the price will come down, the battery will have more range. So one of the issues you have in batteries is that if you look back, we used to joke when I worked on batteries that you have Moore's Law for electronics saying you have a doubling in performance every 18 months, doubling in performance in half the time. In batteries, traditionally, That time period for a doubling performance is about 70 years. Okay. What we're trying to do with this program, lithium ion is today's technology. The applied programs of the Department of Energy are doing a great job of pushing forward lithium ion to make it better every day. We're trying to say, can we do a doubling performance, but instead of in 70 years, can we do it in 5 years? Okay. And the interesting thing here was that the program director here, Dave Danielson, came from a background as a researcher and then as a venture capitalist, where he was looking at funding technologies. And one thing he noticed was there were a lot of great ideas for better batteries, twice the performance battery technologies, that at some point in the past had been funded and tried, but most people were sort of jaded and said, yeah, we don't think it's going to work. And the funding had kind of dried up for a lot of those great ideas. And he said, we need, you know, lithium ion is great, but we need to support an array of new ideas in this space. And so he basically just said, look, it would be completely game-changing if you could get twice the energy density of a battery at a third the cost. That would let you go from Chicago to St. Louis on a single charge, okay, which would cost you about $7. Okay? Why wouldn't you buy that car? Okay? And the interesting thing about this program is that was it. That was basically the target, right? It wasn't, we need a lithium system. We need a, you know, we're not picking what the right answer is. It's just, here's the problem, you know? And so the ideas that came in were across the board. So in this program, we're funding a set of, you know, somewhere again around 10 to 15 projects, which are all different. Some of them are lithium oxygen batteries, right? Some of them are lithium sulfur, right? Not the lithium ion batteries used today. Some of them don't use lithium, right? Metal air batteries, magnesium batteries. We have one battery, which is, you know, we could call the all electron battery, where the proposal, it was so new and unique that it wasn't clear what to call it. Was it a battery? Was it not a battery? It didn't matter, right? It doesn't matter what we get. If it's a great idea and we think it can do this and the reviewer community thinks it can do this, you know, we want to fund it, right? So now we're going to see whether these things work, and hopefully we have a new set of solutions. Sorry, I'm going to introduce Petter because he wants to come in here.
I just wanted to make a comment on this. Also just make a distinction, I guess, between ARPA-E and DARPA to some extent. Cost is something that we think about constantly. It is always a metric, and not to say that DARPA doesn't think about cost, and maybe because of the procurement decline, they might have to think about it more, but I think they think more about robustness and goals. But in the energy sector, we are constantly thinking about cost, and it's always a metric. It is something that in every program we run, we think, will this enter the market at a cost that can actually be used? And BEAST is a good example of that, twice the energy density, that's great, but that second part, one-third the cost, is just as important, because you're not going to buy that car if it costs $200,000.
Let me just insert one point, if I can get this thing
going. I really want to, I'm going to leave on.
All right,
good. I'm going to get beat up here to try and finish up, and then we'll go on. One thing I want to mention is, you know, we're trying to find the best ideas, right? Technology, we're kind of technology agnostic. It's give us your best and brightest. The same thing goes for who we fund, okay? So I mentioned this before, right? We don't care if your idea comes from a national lab, a university, a company, right? If you've got a fantastic idea that aligns with this space, right, you're in the game, okay? And you have an opportunity to get funded. And so the types of folks, our projects tend to be spread between universities, traditional small businesses. They're not all venture capital, right? Traditional small businesses, venture small businesses, large business research groups, where you have a researcher who, sure, you know, is in a large corporation, but is working on something that the corporation's saying, yeah, that's a waste of time. We're not doing that, right? Those are the really interesting ideas that need our support as well. And so that's just another perspective. So just to give you a sense, we have, I just gave a few examples, right? But we've now done 11 focus programs. It's important to note, the first program that ARPA-E launched, we said, here is our mission, right? Again, that very hard filter. This is what we need. Advanced technology, significant impact on these very specific things. Give us your best ideas. We didn't limit it. And so we got 3,700 proposals from across the country. We didn't even know what to do with them, how to review them, because there were so many. But an amazing assortment of ideas, right? Where we did an open, completely open solicitation. Since then, the benefit there is that we can get a lot of ideas from corners of the world and quarters of of the idea space that we never would have thought of. The downside is that we haven't been able to do as thoughtful a job of organizing what exactly are we trying to support, right? And so that was one way that we did things. And then we had these targeted programs where, and I mentioned electrofuels and BEAST and Petrel, right? Those are all related to transportation. One thing I'll note, if you remember, electrofuels, and this is an important piece, electrofuels talks about taking electricity, right, and turning it into transportation fuel. Now, if you think to yourself, well, if what I care about is climate, okay, I'm going to take electricity, which in many parts of the country, you know, we're using coal, right? We're using things that have a lot of emissions, and I'm going to turn it into fuels. That doesn't actually help the climate situation. Well, you're right. But again, remember the mission area, right? Right? Reduce energy imports, increase efficiency, reduce emissions. Emissions is just one piece, right? If we could get all of our transportation fuel from our electricity grid in the U.S., which is mainly domestic, right, we've now come up with a domestic transportation fuel source. Okay, so those mission areas are really, really important. Otherwise, we have a program, HEATS is a program that said, we do a lot with batteries. Batteries are really important, storing electricity. But over 90% of the energy that's used in the world turns into heat at some point. Can we make batteries for heat? Okay, and how do we use those to make the grid more efficient and our vehicles more efficient? Yeah, this is the last slide. Beat It basically said, you know, looked at the history and said, we've had, right, in the last 100 years, there's been extremely little innovation and progress in the efficiency of air conditioning systems. We're about a factor of 10 away from the theoretical limit of efficiency where we could be. So we're trying to really hammer on that one. Impact is for cost-effective carbon capture technologies, so we can do this economically without putting a stress on the industry. ADEPT is a power electronics. If you think about your power cord for your laptop, think about it. It always heats up, right? When the power cord is heating up, that means you're wasting electricity, right? Wasting energy. It's being converted into heat. It's being lost. Right? Turns out that most of our electricity flows through some sort of device like that, whether it's to your laptop or on the grid. So we're trying to get rid of those losses in that program. Grids is grid-scale batteries and energy storage to make the grid more efficient and secure. Solar ADEPT is another power electronics program. Genie is a program thinking about enormously improving the efficiency of the way we move electricity on the grid. And then REACT is a program that we have focused on. How do we get away from the constraint and the security risk of critical materials through new technology? So that's a broad assortment. And I'm going to leave some closing statements for later so that we can get into discussion. But hopefully that brought some perspective.
All right. Well, thank you, Elon, and thanks, everybody. So I want to, before we go to questions, I want to just ask a question to the panel. But before I do that, to me, why this is so critical and why ITIF is such a big supporter of ARPA-E and these kinds of programs is, you know, if we want to solve climate change and if we want to address domestic energy, foreign energy, but there really is no other way to do it than innovation. We can't regulate our way there. We can't price our way there. We can't mandate our way there. You can't solve climate change that way because there are lots and lots of countries in the world that will never, ever adopt clean technologies until the price is cheaper than fossil fuel. And that's really the whole ball of wax right there. And that's why we're so impressed with what you're doing at ARPA-E is that's a big part of the mission is to get that. So when I talk to folks, and ARPA-E seems like it's doing cool stuff, but, you know, look, there's basic research, then there's development. And, you know, why do we need a thing like ARPA-E to do that? I mean, basic research we're funding through NSF and Office of Science, and development's what those VC guys do and those big corporations. So I just don't get what this is all about. That's what you hear from critics, and sort of this is sort of industrial policy. You don't need this. Just keep funding the science and it'll get into the marketplace and these other people will commercialize that. So I'll let anybody or all of you respond to that because I think that is a key, Bill, and make sure your mic's on.
Sure. So one of the big issues in the energy space, which I think everybody in the room understands, is that we've got an innovation system around energy and we've got a significant part of that energy innovation system you know, housed in the Department of Energy, and there are very significant gaps in that system, right? And how do you begin to fill those gaps? So, you know, the world before ARPA-E, if we look within DOE, and this is the front end of the innovation system as opposed to the back end, right? This is the R&D and through the development and early stage demonstration phase, right? The front end of the innovation system. You know, what does that look like within DOE? So we've got an Office of Science that's a Vannevar Bush fundamental research agency, does very important work in a whole range of scientific areas. Pretty important resource to the overall research, fundamental research community. It's got aspects and important parts that are focused on the energy mission, but it's a much broader mission than that, and it's not focused on the challenge model. That's not their model, right? It's a more fundamental kind of organization. And that reports up through a set of stovepipes within the Department of Energy, has its own undersecretary and so forth. Then you got another set of stovepipes on the applied side, right? So you've got a university and lab community that's tied to the Office of Science. Then you've got an industry side that's tied to the applied agencies, you know, particularly ERE and fossil electricity. And they got their own undersecretary. They got their own set of stovepipes, right? Almost nothing goes between those stovepipes. Very little moves, right? So from an innovation gap closing point of view, ARPA-E turns out to be quite important. What are breakthrough ideas that are starting to come out of the fundamental side? And how could you do an innovation accelerator? You know, get these talented program directors that can move stuff in a 3 to 5 year time frame from the idea stage and move it to the applied moment, and then land with the applied agencies and get them to think about, you know, with you about what some of the implementation efforts might be, right? So in my mind, ARPA-E is filling a very important organizational gap in the front end of the innovation system.
Dick, did you want to add to that?
If I can figure out how to get this guy to come on.
I can hand you mine, Dick.
Let me take yours. Okay, good. Delayed function here. Well, you know, we're talking about instigating innovation in a system where you have embedded existing economic interests, vested interests that you're trying to disrupt. The innovation in systems, in terms of capital, in terms of investments, is not open to that, and therefore, as I say in my classes at Georgetown, it's on emerging technologies. And emerging technologies don't just emerge, they're made to emerge. But the system that makes those emerge is not something that just comes naturally out of a incremental investment process. You're doing a change state investment. That kind of change state almost invariably has to have a look ahead time that is different than the typical investment capital world that is looking for easy returns, quick returns, including venture capital. So there, this disjuncture between disruptive innovations that are change state, the existing R&D and technology development systems, and then relating that to the new ideas coming out of science and invention, turning that into new fundamental innovation requires an intervention that I would argue, and I think Greg Tassi would argue, requires a role that is outside of the typical investment structure. And that has been successfully provided by government in almost every instance where we've seen change state investments and innovations made, whether it's in the U.S., or whether it's in Europe, or whether it's in Asia.
Okay. Before Peter goes, just think about your questions. If you have questions, I will turn over to that in just a minute. Peter.
I think another thing to note, you said, like, you know, the Office of Science, the science, and then the VC guys are supposed to take it from there. There's obviously a gap between that, and actually, it's very rare, I think, an agency would ever tell you to do this, but GAO looked at this for us and at behest of a committee, and actually found that we were, generally speaking, we are pre-VC. And most people, of our 120 projects they looked at, they found 12 had gotten VC funding, and then went and talked to those 18. And then they found that we were either significantly accelerating technology beyond that of the VC would have been comfortable, or taking it to the left and making them do something completely different. So I would also note that we're not doing basic science, but GAO looks at us and says, we're not doing basic science, but you're pre-VC, there is a space there. And that, I think, is where the need or where we are at.
I'll just give a quick perspective from anecdote. I think we see the need and the gap kind of every day. And I'll give a few of the responses and reactions that we sometimes get to our work with the folks we're working with, right? So we definitely have cases very often where we will launch an opportunity or point out an opportunity for technology to be relevant. And we get folks that we've decided to fund and folks that haven't that said, you know, I was in the lab doing research on X, Y, and Z. I had no idea, right, that that could be a game changer for this space and this industry. That's kind of one perspective. The other perspective we have is we have projects that we've supported where we know that because we talk about these ideas, we try and get reaction to the ideas, we know that the industry, when we start thinking about it, says, you know, yeah, we've heard about that work, but you know, it sounds kind of crazy, right? We don't think it's going to work. It's definitely way too high risk for us. And even the venture capitalists will say the same things, where later in the project, once they've done some of the work, that story changes, right? And so we see the need for this. And we actually also see industry folks that are dealing with the applications where they turn to us and they said, oh, wow, I never thought about using, you know, heat batteries to increase the range of an electric vehicle. That's not something I checked with R&D group. That's not something we've ever really looked into. We're pretty excited about what you guys are doing there. So we keep seeing these gaps and connections really every day in what we're doing, and I think that's a testament to it.
It's also a lot easier now to be pre-VC since the latest data just came out this week on how the big drop in energy VC investments. So if we have this illusion that we're going to rely on the venture industry to drive this, I think we're missing it. I was also remiss in not introducing my colleague Matt Stepp, who is the clean energy lead clean energy analyst at ITF, who does a lot of this work. So. Folks have questions. I'm going to go in order. I see them. Yes, sir, right here. You can identify yourself as well.
Chuck Manto. I work with inventors and universities and pull them together on innovation. It's very refreshing to be able to hear, like, instead of saying, we got the solution we want you to find, it's good to hear, here's the problem, and what do you think we should do? It's highly refreshing. and I was also impacted by your idea of pulling the losers together in a conference. And the reason I was interested in that is the following. After hearing how your own process is set up, where you go through a workshop process and you get thousands of responses, you have your own timeline and your own methodology and process. So what happens if amongst the losers, you have somebody who says, we just pulled five of us together and we have this breakthrough approach that will immediately make a huge impact, but do you want us to wait for 3 years or 2 years until your next workshop announcement comes? Or is there a way to call up the 911 health desk for ARPA and say, we need to talk, and here are the credentials of the reasons why, is there somebody who's interested? Or is there no one at that help desk to answer that call until the next workshop potential comes around?
Yeah,
you can leave your mics on, by the way.
Oh, there we go. I guess I'd say it actually, I cringed a little bit when you said the losers, because it actually...
it actually
pains us, because we often, you know, we run these things and we often say, you know, if we had the money, we would fund, you know, this many, and then we say, all right, we have the money for half of that. So, you know, they're not quite the losers, they're just, you know, kind of left out. But it's an interesting question, and I think it's one that we sort of struggle with, is what's the mechanism when you have a process in a certain period of time where you're saying, we're going to find innovations in this space at this time, and what happens if 6 months later a brilliant scientist has the breakthrough idea there, or a group of the performers that didn't make it really do better? And we're trying, you know, we're basically trying to continue to evolve the model to make sure that we have a mechanism for capturing that.
So you're saying
Petter has
right
more
now.
To say about that, but
well, generally we also try from time to time we will be doing open rounds. I don't think we have the budget padding to have a open and continuous round just yet. We're much small. I think DARPA has something of that nature, but I think they have a lot more cash. Mm-hmm. So that you're right. This is something we are struggling with, but we also try to have a deliberately open round where no problem is put, just send us your best ideas. And that solves that problem a little bit. It also lets us know what else is out there. A lot of electric fuels actually came from the open round when we saw a couple of these early stage electric fuel type ideas. And so, well, that's interesting. We should go look at that. I think that was basically how we try to address that problem, but it is something we worry about.
I want to let everybody have questions, so if we answer all of them, I really get one question. So I'm going to do an order I saw right here, and then, go ahead, ma'am, do you have your hand up?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
So my question is,
identify yourself.
Oh, I'm Pavia Lau from the Science and Technology Policy Institute, a colleague of Dick's. I could have asked this question at work, but I think I would like to hear a broader answer. So one thing I heard from all of you is that DARPA and ARPA-E are very special. You know, they have special mandates, large sums of money, special hiring authority, other transaction authority. What can other organizations learn? What's the best practice here that, you know, let's say a NIST tip could incorporate without, you know, having new legislation be put in place, which takes longer?
Bill and Dick.
So, look, you know, we've been playing for a while with the idea of maybe we need some DARPA clones, right? And, you know, ARPA-E is certainly out of that thought process. We've tried DARPA clones in a couple of other areas, you know, success in one field, less success, and the inability to quite stand up the model yet in another. So this is a very different organizational model than what we came up with when we kind of locked down our organizational models at the end of World War II and the beginning of the Cold War. That's when most of our science agencies were created 50 years ago. There have been a tiny number of new ones since that time frame. So the ARPA-E model and the DARPA model behind it offer, you know, a different rule set. And what's key there is not creating a new entity. It's thinking hard about that rule set. And could you have a different set of rules, even within an existing R&D agency? You know, you got to create an island for them because they're going to be following a different rule set. But I think that's a potential model. I mean, there's been some thought that the new NCATS organization at NIH, you know, conceivably could pick up some of this rule set and start to play with it. So this innovation accelerator kind of model, this revolutionary breakthrough kind of model that right-left visioning concept, and I'm using Tammy Carlton's phrase for the visioning concept, is not the way we've organized R&D, but it's not inaccessible. We understand a lot about this model now, and there's no reason why other R&D agencies, established though they may be, could play and create sandboxes for this kind of option.
Well, first of all, it's important to realize that DARPA and ARPA-E are not substitutes for the rest of the R&D developments within those organizations relative to the overall challenges, et cetera. And so when you look at other agencies, you have to say, what are they doing in the rest of the R&D space? And how can you use a new organization like this to augment and instantiate and accelerate the output and results from those? And I am relatively convinced that there are opportunities in several other public policy challenge areas, transportation, education, et cetera, where this type of model would be extremely useful, but used with caution. It's not a substitute for the rest of the S&T and R&D that goes on. The crucial notion here is that you can't instantiate these without top-level leadership support, and it has to come through some sort of congressional legislation to allow this to happen, because within an organization, it's likely to die if it doesn't have that.
You know, I think we can be a little bolder, though, because, look, the reason why everybody likes ARPA-E and DARPA is because, A, they don't have civil service protection, and they can actually hire, they can do the same thing that I can do. I can fire people, and I can hire people. And secondly, they can actually go out and buy things kind of when they need to buy things, and they don't take them 9 months. So if we really want to fix the rest of the science establishment in the government, we can do those two things for them, which we're unwilling to do.
It's called technology innovation implementation establishment rather than science establishment. The crucial issue is how do we get to where we need to get in terms of new ideas that transform other areas. And this model, I think, is perfectly appropriate for those, but it's not a panacea.
Yeah, getting the culture right is really hard.
Civil service is a key way to get rid of it, get the culture right when you don't have it.
Yeah, well, I just add to your point, Rob, that I don't believe that ARPA-E could be what it is today without right? Without the structure that sort of the vision of Bart Gordon's and other in Congress, you know, built into it. That said, I also don't believe that the rest of DOE could function extremely well with a lot of those same things, right? We do a lot of interacting with DOE, the rest of DOE, to make sure that we're coordinated, we're not overlapping. And one thing that we see is we face a lot of challenges, right? One example is, you know, in a year, you know, 70% of the folks in ARPA-E, or in 2 years, 70% of the folks in ARPA-E will likely no longer be in ARPA-E, right? And so that's a challenge, and it would be an even bigger challenge. It's not as much of a challenge for us because we're trying to get refreshed and get new ideas. If we're trying to support a long haul on, you know, pushing lithium-ion batteries for vehicles in an incremental way over 20 years as an agency, that would be an enormous challenge for us because we'd be losing all of that knowledge base. So, you know, I don't think it works across the board either way.
Here in the back, I'm going to go on order. So we could like stay till like 12:30. I think at this point. So.
Good morning. My name is Mike Gaughan. I'm with the Army Environmental Policy Institute. I'm an Army War College Fellow. My interest is in transportation energy. My question to the panel is, in terms of back end support, there's been some suggestions that economic incentives and regulatory requirements or mandates would encourage technological implementations. My question to the panel is, what kind of economic incentives or requirements would you suggest to actually make this go forward?
Everybody's looking at me. I mean, I can jump into this, Mike, and thanks for your good question. I mean, obviously, you know, regulation can function in two ways. It can be a deterrent and a lock-in feature for established technologies and sectors, but it also can be a dynamic feature and drive change. So there's a double-edged sword here. Regulation can certainly, you know, play a dynamic role. And obviously that's what was under consideration when we considered, you know, climate change cap and trade legislation. That was going to be the, you know, the driver. I think we failed to think through whether that driver was going to be in sync with the technology evolution from the innovation side, and because we didn't quite get those in sync, it became very difficult to think about the regulatory side. So I think we're in a moment where it's very hard to think about those regulatory moments. You know, I just don't see a lot of regulatory intervention coming soon, and therefore it drives a technology development innovation approach that these guys have been talking about. It drives a very conscious effort to think about what the entry price is going to be as you scale up new technologies. So you've got to contemplate within the R&D process, which normal R&D agencies, frankly, don't do,
30 seconds.
How to get there.
Quickly, transportation, long-haul, trucking, massive costs in terms of fuel and energy. Government has strong regulatory oversight of that, and I think we could provide for fundamental changes in those areas with the right kind of regulations.
You had your hand up in the beginning.
Two questions. I mean, one quick one is, Jackie Roberts, I'm with Environmental Defense Fund. I'm interested in the ARPA-E model, whether there's any role of international researchers, if they're part of a team, is that okay? I mean, we're trying to improve U.S. science and technology. So one quick question there. And then the other thing we're watching very closely is, you know, what's going on with natural gas prices and how that could shift a lot of your challenge statements and your goals. So I don't want to get us off on too much of a tangent, but if you had a quick thought on that.
I would say that the work has to be, our the way we operate, is work has to be done in the U.S. And so if they move here, that's fine. But right now, we couldn't have the work done in Sweden or China or anything like that, so they'd have to do that. That being said, there are examples of companies that have moved from Europe, for example, and are actually doing the work in the U.S. So they just relocated and did the work here. There's also some, in our contracts, we require, if going forward, a substantial amount of the IP should be here as well. We don't preclude anybody, and it doesn't stop anybody from setting something up.
Another comment on the international front. I think we have a strong interest in the international community, and one of the areas it comes out is, you know, we're really interested in finding innovations that get developed in the U.S., right? But for many of these areas, the international community, places like Europe, in terms of the implementation, in terms of a need for energy storage on the grid, as an example, it might be a much more pressing need in somewhere like Europe. That might be where the market is starting to develop. And so we're very interested in understanding what's happening internationally, because those might be the markets that these technologies sell into, right? So I think that's interesting. On the national gas point, it triggered for me, I don't remember whether it was Dick or Bill, who said, you know, I wish that, you know, when ARPA-E was created, the president would have issued a challenge, right? I don't know if many of you heard, but the president recently sort of issued a challenge to the Secretary of Energy saying, how do we get natural gas to be used for transportation? You wouldn't be surprised to hear that that's certainly something that we're very actively thinking about. So,
right over here. Sir.
Thank you so much. My name is George Mihais. I'm from Norway. So if I understood correctly, you accept foreign ideas. General question. My second question, we develop in Norway air purification technology, 50 projects tested it, and it turns out that efficiency of energy is dramatically impacted positively.
Could you repeat the technology in here?
Air purification, indoor air purification technology. So we tested it in hospitals, schools, residences, over 50%. But it turns out that air conditioning industry ventilation sees some threats. Now, I set up a company here in the United States, and we're looking for opportunities to roll out this technology internationally.
Now,
is there any way we can approach you?
So if you're a U.S. company and you plan to do the work in the U.S., and the technology really is an advanced breakthrough technology that has a significant impact on one of these missions, we certainly want to hear from you.
Thank you so much.
Great. Right back here, and then here. Yeah, you're right there.
George Sturzinger, just a quick plug for regulation. This is one of those things that amazes me sometimes that it's disappeared, but the 2005 and 2007 Energy Act had the Renewable Fuel Standard, a mandate for 36 billion gallons of biofuels, 15 ethanol, 21 advanced biofuels, so it shows, and if you look at the industry and look at VC money going into it, and you look at the coordination with loan guarantees and other supports, it's a model, I think, of how things should be done, and it shouldn't be lost sight of.
Okay.
We at least did one thing right.
Right here.
Ben Ballard from the Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Lab. Question for the group. How many working scientists and engineers are in the room?
Is that good or bad?
Are we reaching the individual innovators? Here.
Well, they're not. Well, obviously, they're not sitting right in front of you. But it's something we do think about. So, they are definitely, when we think of communications or how we speak, we constantly think of how we're going to communicate to innovators, to obviously Congress, they hold the purse strings, but also the potential business community that will see and know what we're doing. Those are the three areas we try to hit. Every time we say something, we try to hit that group. And part of the reason the summit was created was to get that group together. And it is a tight-knit community. It's amazing when I'm walking around with a Dr. Majumdar through an airport, someone will walk by and he's like, oh, that guy wrote a paper on X, a neutrino thing or something. And so it is something we worry and think about. And we think we're doing an okay job at it, but, you know, we're trying to get better at it, and I think that's our focus.
Right in the very back.
Ryan Trinium, AAAS fellow, EERE and DOE. And I have a question about DARPA activities. Does the advent of ARPA-E preclude DARPA from doing anything in energy?
No, it doesn't preclude it. If it's national security oriented and has broader possibilities, DARPA has done a lot of work in batteries and alternative fuels, et cetera, and is now doing it more cooperatively with ARPA-E. So the answer is yes and yes.
Right here.
Anita Balachandra with Tech Vision 21. I was intrigued in the open competition, the first open competition, you identified two gaps, two valleys of death, if you will. And I was intrigued by your comment today about how many of your projects you're finding are actually pre-VC. I was wondering whether you've ever plotted your funded projects across those two valleys. Are they generally evenly distributed in terms of being, do you know what I'm saying? Or does that even matter?
Well, I'll give you a sense. I mean, I think the intention is to find something which is at a very high risk point, and the technology is the risk point, and try and minimize the technology. And so the way I would describe it is our projects fall into two camps. I don't know if Petter would agree with this, but I think our projects fall into two camps. We have some set of earlier stage projects where a scientist has come up with an idea, right? Brand new idea, and we're not even sure whether the scientific principles have been proven. And so there, you know, the idea is, okay, let's go from something which I have no idea whether this is even scientifically sound and prove that. Right, where if you did prove it, you'd say, okay, wow, now this is worth continuing the work. The other set, which I think is the bigger set in terms of the ratio, are areas where the scientific principles have been proven. There's an idea that this could be used for, a prototype could be built with far better performance, but no one's actually reduced it, right? No one's actually built a prototype and shown that these ideas can be assembled to create something practical. And so many of our projects are to kind of create that first, you know, laboratory prototype, which says, yeah, this is a really game-changing technology which can work. And so if you think about, for instance, the venture capital mindset, which you brought up, and I have a lot of experience with that group, normally that's what they want to see to be able to invest, that, yes, you've actually built something, and we have a reasonable belief that that's real and it can work and it can give you the value you're saying in the technology.
Okay, just a couple more right here. Okay.
So question for
identify you yourself.
Oh, I'm Will Turner with the U.S. China Business Council. Bill mentioned the challenges of kind of parachuting into a legacy sector where there's established interests there that they're competing against. Have you ever thought about how, and you mentioned like your what technology is combining big oil and big tobacco. Have you ever thought about bringing big oil on downstream in the process so that you have an established interest that if they feel threatened, they may not appreciate the activity, but if you show them that there's real business opportunity for them there, then maybe they go from being an opponent to being an advocate. And one idea that I kind of jotted down here was maybe you set up a matchmaking session where, say, a company like Chevron could sit down with 10 to 15 startups that can pitch to them about how they're going to help them, give them a competitive advantage by helping them transition from being from black oil to green oil, for instance.
Yeah, so I think it speaks to one of the differences between ARPA-E and DARPA, which I think was why Dick sort of caught on to that, which is, in DARPA, you're developing technologies for a clear customer, the Department of Defense, that's sitting in the same building, you know, figuratively speaking, in the same building, right? The technologies we're supporting generally have to get adopted by the industry for there to be some impact. So that's very important to us. And the way we think about that, we try and engage with everyone. So you mentioned, you know, could a big oil company meet with some of the projects? Actually, at our summit, there is an opportunity for any big company, and it's part of the reason we do it. We showcase the technology so the big companies can see what's happening and see what's being done. We're also thinking about what those big companies would actually adopt from a technology standpoint to help us figure out what programs we want to run and help the technologies develop in the right way. So yeah, I think you hit it right on.
Let me make a quick insertion. It's not necessarily big oil, it's big energy, and that big energy is kind of similar to big defense in the sense that you have to bring in these partners because they're the way in which these things get implemented. In DOD, things that don't get into defense systems through the services and through the defense contractors, so those linkages have to be developed and you have to create the incentives on their part. In fact, most of the defense applications are later employed and by the defense contractors, the Boeings, the Lockheed Martins, et cetera. That motif, I think, is something to look forward to as if the energy companies see themselves as energy companies with alternative energies as opposed to just big oil companies. And I think that some of them are starting to think that way.
So the last question right here.
Thanks. Mark Dutz, World Bank. I'm trying to think through the differences between the ARPA-E model and relatively similarly structured prizes. And I guess one of the differences with just putting out prizes in areas you think would be interesting is you actually empower program managers. I was wondering if there's any data showing the relative effectiveness of that the ARPA model, the DARPA model, versus prizes?
Prizes are a mechanism that can be used by either one of those organizations, and so it's only it's one motif and one approach. It's useful and applicable, but it is not something different from DARPA or something different from ARPA-E. It's a one new way, an approach for doing it. It's been very successful in certain things, but it only proceeds to a certain point, and it doesn't really do the development of the proof of principle prototypes in these focus areas the way in which some of these other kind of grant type mechanisms do. So it's part of the quiver. It's one of the tool in the quiver.
But it's not a substitute for undertaking R&D. It's going to have to build on that talented research community that's going to have to come through that R&D system.
Basically,
yeah, I mean, RBE has the authority to do prizes, and we've had a lot of debate internally about why, a lot of debate, because it's exciting. Prizes are exciting. Why would we do a prize versus the mechanism that we've gone with so far? And we see advantages and disadvantages. One of the advantages is you can access a much broader community of folks participating, which is great. One of the big disadvantages, though, is that what we find in hearing from our projects and our awardees is that they get a lot of value from having a technical expert who's the program director going and, you know, either in person or meeting with them every quarter and helping them develop their technology towards a goal in terms of being a sounding board, et cetera. And that's just not something we'd be able to offer and have that value in a prize.
So maybe you could do a prize for the best clean energy technology policy paper.
Again, you got to think about the mission area. So
I would also note that we met with XPRIZE multiple times, and they gave a couple principles on what's a good prize and what's a bad prize. A couple things about prizes. First of all, the person has to have the capital to do the thing for the prize. Whereas a grant, you can have the idea, but you don't have to have the capital. They said never make the test subjective. So a paper.
quite objective.
Right. They also said make it clear. So they've had a lot of great prizes. They also failed a lot. So make the process a clear winner to your grandmother. So it has to be a car that crosses the line first, something that lifts something that's heavier than something else. If it's just more theoretically efficient, and they said you kind of need the Mythbusters blow-up factor as well. It needs to be a race, there needs to be a crash, there needs to be an excitement aspect of it. And sometimes when we're doing a grant or research, you don't want any of those things. Sometimes you want them all. They have some really interesting ideas on how to test batteries and energy density using hovercrafts, because the lighter the battery, the longer the hovercraft stays up. For other aspects, it just doesn't fit. We are struggling with this, though. I think DARPA has done prizes just also. Yeah.
So before we close, I just wanted to see if Congressman Gordon, if you wanted to just have any last words, any thoughts you had from listening to all of this that you wanted to share?
Well, first, as usual, Rob, you pulled together a great panel and gone on a very good element of discussion. I guess if you were going to ask me, or I was going to ask me a question, I'd ask me, you know, what are the two or three challenges now facing the DARPA, or ARPA-E? And I think you have to step back, as Petter and I have been talking about. There have been a number of one vote, one day type of life or death experiences with RPE. It is by no means assured that RPE will continue. The funding could be taken out. Another president could not like it. So anyway, I would hope that all of you that think it is positive, there are some support groups. So one would be that. The second challenge, and this was Arun had he's got a little group that advises him, and at the last one at the seminar, he asked a question: what's the biggest challenge facing RP? And I said that it was a succession plan. This somewhat has been mentioned. Arun himself is a major issue there, but these program directors, they really are the ones that drive things, and the enthusiasm they have, the knowledge they have, the commitment that they have, I'm optimistic that with recruiting you're going to get that, but that's still a real challenge and to keep that going. And I guess the third challenge was sort of mentioned earlier on this, the valley of death. I think that one of the big challenges that RPE has now is certainly, there are those two valleys of death. The first one is sort of proof of concept and whatever, $2 or $3 million. And then you got to demonstrate that you can scale it out, which is, you know, maybe $10, $20 million. And I think ARPA-E has to find a way to hand these off. To some extent, maybe you can hand them off to venture. I think that we need to be looking within the federal government, SBIR, wherever it might be, but you got to hand these things off to get them next. So those are the, that's what I would try to confuse myself with if I was going to ask them.
Let me be so bold and say, if you don't fix challenge one, the others are moot.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
So that's the key challenge for the next few years. So anyway, we've gone over our time partly because it looked like you were all interested, and I was certainly interested. It was a great discussion. So if you have further questions, just feel free to come on up. This is also going to be archived on our website if you want to share the video and link with other folks. So please join me in thanking four great panelists.